The other story comes from a pastor named Kelly Fryer, and the bus story. She talks, tells about how her daughter, when she was in kindergarten, had rode the bus to school. And anybody ever have to ride the bus to school when you're a kid, all right? You know, there are all these different grades, and when you're a little kid, it's kind of scary because of these big kids. And her daughter came home in tears one day because two boys who were probably in eighth grade were picking on this boy who was in second grade. You know, the kind of kid who has the really thick glasses and he's really, really bright, probably he'll discover the cure for the common cold when he grows up. But in second grade, he just doesn't fit in and he's picked on a lot. So these boys were picking on him. And she was telling her mom about it, and what really bothered her is she knew these two boys because they were in the confirmation class that her mother taught because she was the pastor of the church. And her mom said, you know, she said, listen, I'll talk to them. I'll take care of it. And then I said, oh, no. And she said, I already took care of it. She said, I told them, you know, to pick on someone their own size. And I remember when she told this story, and used it since. I remember even Joshua did it once for an adult sermon, to talk to the adults like they were, you know, like a kid's sermon. And she asked us the question like he did, you know, who was the church in that story? Who was the church? Huh? The little girl? Right. She said, yeah, we want to, you know, we like to say the little girl. She said the right thing, but the two boys, weren't they the church too? You know, and to realize that we, you know, when we live in this world where we separate things, it's like, you know, we're the church only when we get together on Sunday mornings. Outside of that, we're just ourselves. Or, you know, even the story with the woman, the synagogue, I think it's a beautiful story about how we're supposed to be this community of forgiveness. You know, like the second one, we're supposed to be a community of accountability, you know, reminding each other of what it is we're about. But often the way we do church keeps us from that. You know, the story of the synagogue lady, what did the rest of the church do for those two women? They kept them apart. They kept them from ever dealing with the issue. For how long? For 7 years. How many of us have had brokenness in relationships that we long for healing, that maybe have even gone beyond 7 years? You know, because there's no one who's helped us to go there. You know? Or how many times have we done something we shouldn't have done and we wish there was someone who would tell us to pick on someone our own size, or, you know, or that there's a better way of doing it. I think a lot of times the way we've structured church has not let us really be community. It hasn't let us connect in those ways. And when you look at the stories of Jesus, that was what Jesus was really about. When he wasn't in church buildings or synagogues, when he was out in the streets and meeting with real people and talking about the things they were struggling with their relationship with each other and with God, and inviting them to a new way. In fact, click the next one. The next one, we'll come back to that story. What is the scripture passage, if we could? I kind of had them in different order, sorry guys. The scripture passage where Jesus says, seek first his or God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. All right? So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Just say the first thing we're supposed to, that we should be centered about is the kingdom of God. And I love this this version of the message we click on. In the message it says, steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find all your everyday human, thank you, concerns will be met. One more. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now, and don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. To see, you know, center yourself in God, create a reality, you know, that everything is in God, and to live that way. And I think when we've been talking about this journey, we're saying, you know, there's three things that we really want to center ourselves in. One is the identifying with Jesus and the way that Jesus lived. And you look at the stories of the Bible and you see this Jesus who was deeply concerned about people and where they were right now and what was happening in their lives, and that God was there and inviting them to a new way. We talked last week about God is everywhere, transforming secular space and living as if there is no secular, that everything is sacred, that God is in everything, and we want to live that way. And if we do that, then we also need to live as community, that we need each other, that we can't be on a journey alone. You know, we've tried it. Very nice. You distracted. You know, that we are community. And it's interesting to me, if we go back to that church song, this is a song by a guy named Jay Beach, and I remember singing this at Bible camp when I was a kid. And he says, we are the church, the body of our Lord. We are all God's children, and we have been restored. And it's interesting, the word church, actually, in Greek, it's ekklesia, you know, and we translate it as church, but the word doesn't mean building at all. It means gathering. It's when people are together. It's being together. In fact, when Jesus said, two or three are gathered in my name, that we're being church then. It's like, you know, it's about this community. And so it's about relationships. And that we've been restored, that God has done something to change the way of our lives. Then he said, the church is not a building where people go to pray. It's not made out of sticks and stones. It's not made out of clay. Why do we keep calling those building churches then? You know, it's like we're still stuck in that way of dealing with things, and this building is what's sacred, you know. You know, and so it's only what happens there on Sunday morning. And we even struggle with this. I mean, we don't have our sacred building. We've been moving in different places. We've been in the theater, and we've been here in the high school, and even in different rooms because of remodeling the cafeteria. You know, but we treat Sunday morning as this time, as this is the sacred time, right? This is it. You know, this is the only place, but it's not that. It says, now you go to worship, but you can't go to church, right? You can't find a building that's alive no matter how you search. Anybody found one? You know, we're God's living presence. The church is not a business, a committee or a board. It's not a corporation for the business of the Lord. You know, I have to tell you, you know how many times people have said to me, you know, the church is really a business, right? Budget, you got programs, things you got to run. You know, well, you know, I think when we function that way as church, then we become a business and we forget about what we're here about. It says the church, it is the people living out their lives, called, enlightened, sanctified for the work of Jesus Christ. That what we're called to do is to live out the way of Jesus in the world, to be together, that God has invited us, God has called us, God has opened our eyes to see the way the world is, and God is changing us to be God's people in the world and to change the world. So we are the church. We are the body of Jesus. We are God's children, and we're the ones that have been restored. You know, it was interesting this past week being on this mission trip because, you know, the experience is that. It's saying we are living out God 24/7, right? Even if sleeping, you're in rooms, you're hanging out, you're, you know, the guys room, the girls room, you're sleeping together, the people you're on a mission trip with, you got your, you know, your inflated mattresses, you know, kind of lined up in rows, you know, people talking late in the night about things that happened that day. We get up in the morning, you know, your group, you might make breakfast that day with your group. Everyone's eating meals together at tables and sharing. You know, we go to a morning devotion time together and spend time with God to center our day in God. And then we go on our cruise to enter the lives of other people, not just so we can touch them, but they can touch us. We're in nursing homes and in soup kitchens, working at centers, serving youth and doing all kinds of things, working on buildings and painting. And then we come back together to spend some time together. We share a meal. We go out to see other things going on in the community. And then we spend time in worship that night. And we sit down at the end in our groups from our communities to talk about what happened and how we saw God moving. And I can remember one of the last nights we were there, we were talking to one of the kids from Faith that had gone with us. He said, you know, he says, I want to stay here all summer with these people. Right? I want to be together with these people all summer. Right? I just want to stay here. This is just really great. You know, they're tired, they're working hard, and I just want to be here all the time. And I think that's the kind of community that God has invited you to live as a community, to go beyond just Sunday morning, but to say, what does it look like if we live this out all the time? And it's not just that we're just hanging together, you know, all of us, although I think it's important we get together in other places, but saying, what does it look like if we live this out in all the places we go, and in all the people we meet, we realize that Jesus is present here, that God is at work and moving in what we're doing. And what would that look like if we did that all the time? It was interesting. I was talking to one of the leaders. Her name was Kinsley, and we were riding to Leon's Custard. Anybody heard of Leon's Custard? Remember Happy Days, the Fonz, you know, right? Leon's Custard is the, if you watch the show, that's the place they go to, you know, like the driving thing. That's Leon's Custard. You know, it's really good custard. I thought that Culver's is just as good, but that's me. You know, we got to introduce Canadians and West Virginians to custard. They never had it before. But just talking with Kinsley on the way, and one of the leaders there, there's only four leaders, and there's 74 of us. You know, they're just kind of there to help guide us as we do this. But she was saying, you know, she said she never heard of YouthWorks before last December, but she wanted to do something in the summer where she could really live up for God in everything. She said, it's been a really great experience, but she said, you know, we get to know each other for a week, and then you all leave, and then it's a whole new group. She said, and I hear stories, and yet I can't walk those places with people. So I have a friend who's part of another ministry, so where he went for 9 months, you know, and really got to immerse himself in others in relationships and sharing. Says, you know, he said, that's really great. You know, she said, I long for something like that. And I realized as we were talking that we were both longing for that, but we weren't just longing for like 9 months. We were saying, we were really longing for a whole life in a community where we could do that together, the journey together. And as I've been reading about this, you know, the church and where we're going, there have been a number of churches that really struck me about how they've been exploring that too. And it was interesting because one of the things they said is that most of them are only like 15 to 40 people. And the reason they're 15 to 40 people is because they've come together because they're all longing to be in a journey of faith. And that's what brought them together. And other folks might come in and out, but if they really aren't hungry for that, they don't tend to stick. You know, because you really have to share deeply you know, if you want to go those places. And they gather beyond just Sunday morning to explore that together and the things that they do. And so that, you know, that if you really long for the kingdom, if you really want to be a journey of faith, the people who are like that will be drawn together. So it's hard to go beyond that. You have to, you know, you have to say, let's start other communities, because when you get any bigger, it becomes like the church that it's been. It's become an institution and not a family. And so, you know, I think we want to explore this. Say, you know, what happens then is that you don't keep growing, you know, like you see with the mega churches. What you do is you help start other communities like that, where people can journey deeply together. And they use the language of family, and it was really interesting to me, because, you know, how do we get to be part of a family? We're born into it. You know, we might be adopted into it, but, you know, we didn't have a whole lot of choice, you know, in it most of the time. So we're just kind of there. So we're together because it happened. Whereas in the church, we're together because we've been longing for God. There's this journey we're on, and we just know it's what we need. It's like Peter talking to Jesus, you know, when Jesus has said some hard things and people are leaving, and Jesus says to Peter, are you guys going to leave too? I'm like, well, where the heck else are we going to go? You're the one who has these words of eternal life. You know, you're the one who has what we're longing for. It's hard, but where the heck else are we going to go? You know? In fact, you know, Jesus says it, like, he says, you know, if you really want to go this way, you're going to have to take up the cross. You're going to have to go in a difficult place. But if you really want life, this is where it's found. And so, you know, Jesus, it was interesting. Jesus' family, we talk about family being this thing that we hold together to. And you know what happened? Jesus' family came looking for him. You know what he did? He ignored them. They wanted to come in. He said, tell them to come out and talk to us. All these people are gathered around him. He says, look, he says, that's not my family. I said, I might have been born in them, but this is my family. He says, the people who want to do God's will, he said, those are my brothers and sisters and mother. You know, we talk about blood is thicker than water. Well, the reality is, you know, we become part of this family through the waters of baptism, that water is really thicker than blood. But this is the place that really binds us, that this is the community. We need to explore that together. In looking at many of the churches who are doing this, one of the things that is interesting is many of them have gone away from a Sunday worship service. Right? And I think this is the thing maybe we need to wrestle with, because the reason they did that is it became like Mr. Bean here. We just did it, we got together, but it really wasn't deep community. You know, people gather that mindset, it's only Sunday morning. And I think it's important to have time when we can gather together, but if it's just, you know, because that's what we do, you know, I don't, is that helping? But if it's a place that helps us to connect and go beyond just Sunday morning, and where we can build relationships, then I think it's really important. But we need to go beyond that. And most of those churches looking at it are saying, you know what? What's really important is that we're together even throughout the week, that even like family, we may not like each other, all of us, you know, the best, but, you know, if we're this journey together, then we need to really wrestle with that. Like the cinnamon roll lady and the brownie lady, that, you know, we need to, God puts us in those places to deal with those differences we have, to help us to forgive and to love and invite others in this journey of being real. So I'm going to invite us in this to explore what it means to live as community, to explore what it means to identify with Jesus, to live as if everything is sacred. And next week we're going to go kind of our next step of saying, if those things are really important to us, if we identify with Jesus, we want to walk the way that Jesus wants, if we understand that God is in everything and everything is sacred, and that we need to live as community, that it's only in this place that we can really be on this journey of faith together, then we'll begin to see things happening. Like next week, we'll be a place that welcomes the stranger. And we want to explore that, because it was very important. Hospitality was central to the way of Jesus. And I think often we kind of struggle with that. We like, you know, our homes are, a man's home is his castle. And a castle, how do you define a castle? It's got walls, the drawbridge, and the moat. You know, we want to be a place that's about welcoming. So let's close this time with prayer.